For the last one, I'd like to introduce Ashwin Ram from Manage Engine. Manage Engine have sponsored the session today, which allows us to make it freely available to members and to non-members. Ashwin's going to be looking at remodeling the healthcare service management framework to tackle modern cybersecurity issues. Over to you, Ashwin. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you, Mark. And it was really a great session hearing from all the other people, particularly hearing from people who are on the front line handling critical IT service management practices. I think I'm the one, the odd man out of the lot, right? From a vendor who is more like a consultant or a best practice a recommendation provider. So I've been in the industry for about 10 years. And like Mark said, I work for Manage Engine. I started as a content writer, and now I handle the marketing operations for Service Desk Plus, which is the IT service management platform from Manage Engine. So over the 10 years, and being in Manage Engine, it has helped me have kind of a bird's eye view on all the developments that have been happening on the whole spectrum of IT management functions from an ITSM perspective. And over the last, I would say, 4 or 5 years, or particularly after COVID-19, one major trend that we have been seeing is that there has been an increased focus on security or cybersecurity. The reason is we are seeing a lot of cybersecurity issues that we probably did not see earlier, or probably the scale was not as much as what it is now currently. Say, for example, two very interesting incidents. Now, one is an incident in Florida, which happened in a water treatment plant, where an hacker got access to their systems and was able to increase the level of sodium hydroxide in the water of about 100 times, I assume. Now, this is because, very simply because, the hacker got access to the remote access tool credentials that the team was sharing. He got into the system and moved laterally and exploited the system. Now, this is one incident which could have been handled with a little bit of privileged access management practice. On the other side, a very recent incident where an engineer handling some activity for the Paris Olympics, which is coming up in the next few years, he recently lost a bag, which supposedly has a laptop and two pen drives, which hold sensitive information about the upcoming Olympic event. Now, this again, on the base of it, could have been handled with efficient IT management and endpoint management functionalities. So over the last few months, this thought struck us that ITSM, being the most process-driven function of all the IT management functions, and particularly the function which ties together all the aspects of IT management with our incident management, service request management, change, IT asset management, etc., we no longer can afford to be outside the IT, outside the security operations or SecOps. You know, we ITSM people should start incorporating the SecOps functionalities, SecOps thought process within our IT service management functions. And this presentation, probably the next 20 minutes, is going to be about just that. We will try to present to you some simple ITSM practices, how we handle now, and what are the important security flashpoints that are missed or potentially overlooked as a part of this IT service management functions. And I'll showcase how to incorporate the security mindset within the IT service management processes itself. Now, like how I explained the two use cases, I'm sure you know the importance of security or cybersecurity is high in the NHS situation also, particularly with respect to the level of data, the sensitivity of data that NHS handles. Now, before I start, a quick validation on the importance of cybersecurity, right? We have seen the number of cybersecurity attacks increasing. The cyber insurance premiums has increased in the US the last 2 years. The number of ransomwares have increased. the cost of data breaches is highest ever now than what we have seen earlier. Now, with all this, like I said earlier, we ITSM professionals can start incorporating SecOps thought process and functionalities into our everyday practices. In order to establish this, I'll talk about 7 simple use cases and tie up one key lesson or learning where you can bring in or remodel your ITSM practices or ITSM framework with a security first approach. Now, talking of the first case, an IT help desk team receives 3 incidents from a user. Now, at a very surface level, these seem very isolated. One, the user reports that his machine is slow. And then at some point, he comes back asking to unlock his account or with password resets because he says that he gets getting locked out of his account automatically. Now, on the outlook, these seem like 3 very different incidents and the IT team solves it. But what they did not know was that now this was a ticking time bomb and they ended up having a ransomware attack which encrypted all their workstations. So to dissect what happened, the first incident is a slow workstation incident reported by the end user. And the IT team restarts all the intensive processes, reboots the system, and closes the incident for now. So the incident is sorted. Second, the user complains of a lot of password resets or accounts getting unlocked. And again, the team unlocks his account, sends in password reset link, the incident is closed. But the final blow comes in a third incident, and this time not from the user, but with a warning message across all their workstations because now they have a ransomware attack where all the data is encrypted. They bring in the whole system. They realize it's a major incident. They bring in all the operations team, work on it, identify the source. A major incident is created. Major incident response is created, and they tackle it. But if you look at it, at the base of it, this was because the user's laptop was not patched properly, and this unpatched version was exploited by a threat actor. Now, looking at it, we have 3 incidents, of which 2 are close, probably within the SLA and up to the satisfaction of the user. But ultimately, this ended up affecting the business with a ransomware attack. So how do we look at this incident management from a security perspective? How should our incident management practices look like? Ideally, the first point, like I said, the patch complaints data, which comes here in the diagnosis part. But if the team has information on the patch complaints of the IT infrastructure, they can identify the potentially vulnerable devices on their network and work on fixing them immediately. Now, looking from the case of an incident, even before the end user raises an incident, ideally, fail logon attempts or multiple password reset requests or multiple account locks should be generated as an alert in SIEM tools and then converted into a ticket in the service desk team so that the service desk team looks into the incident and starts validating if this is a security incident and moves on into the triage stage. So instead of waiting for the user to come to us with multiple incidents and manually the team trying to connect the dots, we need to have processes in place. I assume most teams have some level of data security monitoring put in place already. So it's just a matter of tying together the data security monitoring silo with the IT service management practices, in this case, incident management. So there is a seamless transition. Now, pushing it a little bit advanced into the UEBA, which is user entity and behavior analytics, where the system continuously looks for patterns. And now when it notices a user trying to access a particular system from a different environment, a different laptop or a different IP address, it could throw in a warning to the IT help desk system or the IT service management team, informing of a potential breach into their network. So this is a simple incident management process. Now the parts that you see in yellow are all the security aware parts, and the ones in beige are the usual incident management practice. So this way, we need to have specific areas of security focus across each step in our incident management practice to become more security aware and to also increase the cybersecurity level of any environment, particularly for a very sensitive environment like NHS. And so the lesson from this is, one, treat patch management complaints as a highly important factor and convert user account logs, data security monitor alerts into tickets into your ITSM system so that your team can work on it, validate it, and initiate a security response if needed. So this is the first story and the first lesson which will help to remodel our ITSM practices with a security first focus. And to the second case, right? Onboarding and offboarding on employees. Now, this is one use case which we have constantly talked about to our end users, to our customers, to our prospects. And in fact, this is one of the use cases that we showcase in our user conferences to show how people should ideally onboard or offboard employees. But in spite of all the talk around onboarding and offboarding, all the workflows that we have, there can be some gaps, particularly which can lead to security issues. Now, take this case of a company who have multiple contractors being onboarded and offboarded every single day. And look at the contractor one. Now, this is a set of activities that have to be performed when an employee is getting offboarded or when a contractor is getting offboarded. But though this company has all this information on paper, they lack the automation. So what happens is the HR team informs the IT service desk team, the ITSM team starts the manual offboarding process, but it is not repeated, it is not completed across the board. So for one user, the asset is not deprovisioned, which means that the user leaves with the company asset, probably with some user accounts and with some privileged access enabled for the user. Some of the passwords that a contractor had access to were not reset, or the shared resources were not cut access of. So a lot of these potentially security touch points being missed due to the lack of automation, particularly with respect to privileged access management. So here the point is, though the company is aware of the various activities they have to do to fill up these security loopholes, they did not set up the necessary automation from the IT service desk platform into their privileged access management platform, which led to the security loopholes, which could eventually lead to a lot of security issues. So how do they reorganize their offboarding process? So ideally, when this HR team sends the list of offboarding requests to the ITSM team, the ITSM team should trigger out and privileged workflow automation, which will revoke privileged access permissions that have already been provided to that particular contractor, clean up all standing privileges, and rotate passwords if needed, cut off access, and ultimately delete the user from the system, and then move on to carry out the IT tasks to onboard this employee, which is collecting the asset, disabling AD user, email accounts, etc. Do a privileged audit for verification, and then finally close this request. So from this point, where a lot of activities are manual, to a point where activities including privileged workflow automation is triggered as a part of workflow automation. So this is a critical point in any organization where onboarding and offboarding, one of the most repeated practices, could lead to security issues, and how you can close them by incorporating one small aspect, which is privileged workflow automation, within the offboarding service request management. So the second learning, bring in privileged access management within the service management workflows. Now, say, for example, remember the Florida use case that we talked about, where the exploit happened because of shared access to the remote access tool. Well, this could have been avoided if the whole process was handled as a service request with the necessary approvals for a defined time to that particular technician, and revoking the privileged access to the remote access tool once the task that the technician needed to is closed, they could have avoided that incident. So this is the second point. And now coming to the third case, which is the case of an IT change, which is where an acquisition happens in a pharma company. And now, in order to unify their tech stack, they have to upgrade their databases. So this is a major change. The change get rolls out. It is actually a success. No downtime. All the functionality is tested. They go live. The release goes out as planned. Everything goes out smooth until a month later, where they realize an internal threat actor has released sensitive data, which were a part of the backup taken during this change implementation into the dark web. So here, even though the company's change management practice was watertight, from submission to closure to review, everything was done perfectly. The change was implemented, did not affect business at that time, but some minor security lapses led to a huge security issue, leading to leakage of data into the public network. So to look at their change management practice, this is the recommended change management practice that you can see across any organization, right? Starting with submission, creating a backup, upgrading the database, testing the environment, passing application writing to the DB, switching to the new cluster, and reviewing it and closing it. But across each of these stages, there could be potential security risk points. Now, say, for example, the first point, where we create a backup for the existing DB before we start the unification of the technology stack, there is a potential for data theft. Some internal person who luckily, or who as a part of the change implementation got full access to the DB, could access the data in the database where he's not supposed to. So that is one risk point which should be addressed as a part of this change implementation. The second point, when the upgrade happens, someone could just execute a code or inject a malicious code into the system, which again opens up security risks. And finally, without proper logs on who had access to what part of the database, at what point in time during the change management or the change implementation, and what particular codes were executed during this change implementation, when a mishap happens, it is very hard to go back and pinpoint the actual point of vulnerability that has happened. So just to contrast, a really watertight change management practice from an ITSM perspective, but with a little bit of security lapses across each stage. Now, how do we fix this, right? So a few very quick security aspects at each point. The first one, access provisioning system, where instead of providing complete access to the database operations for everyone involved in the change, ensuring that we have a zero trust environment where we provide the minimum privilege needed for that person for that particular amount of time during the change execution. Now, that is one thing. So from an ITSM perspective, you set the change management process, have your CAB approve the change, look through the planning, take it into implementation. Now, just add a layer of security focus where you just provide the necessary access or the minimum access to the person during the change implementation. So this way, you cut off access to the database for everyone involved in the change. Next, file integrity management, wherein you also monitor your backup files to ensure that they are not tampered with or they are not accessed by people who are not supposed to access it. So this way, we ensure that the backup that we have taken remains untampered and out of risk of getting leaked into the system. And the whole execution part is where the privileged session monitoring comes in. Now here, this is important from a cybersecurity insurance point, right? So say an incident and security incident happens, and now your cybersecurity insurance auditors want to know what exactly happened. So ideally, all these operations that happen on the database should be monitored, should be recorded, and added into your change request for a later audit or for a later review. So these are some of the security aspects that can be brought over the change management layer to ensure that we make our ITSM practices secure also, or like our title suggested, taking a security first approach to IT service management practices like change management practice. So taking an absolutely watertight, solid, best practice change management approach and adding a layer of security awareness across various touch points to ensure that the changes that the IT service management teams, the IT professionals like us roll into the environment is also highly secure. So wrapping up the final pillar, weave in the zero trust principles wherever possible into the IT service management practices like change management. Just a sec. Yes. And now coming back, the fourth case is an IT asset management story. So here again, a company, now say the company that we have been seeing across all these three stories, a team that has faced multiple cybersecurity incidents, vulnerabilities, exploits. Now they want to ensure that they comply with NIST or CIS frameworks to improve their security awareness. They now hit a roadblock where, because of some gaps in their IT asset management practices. Here again, now this is a best practice IT asset management practice, asset management practice, right? Starting with asset discovery, asset classification, and building an asset inventory, mapping your assets to users, having remote access, and then classifying IT assets, cloud services, network devices, software, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. On paper, it looks fine. But what happens when an asset is stolen, or when you have rogue assets in your network that you're not able to discover and inventory them into your system? These are potential risk points in your IT asset management. So how do we add this? So the first point, ensure that we increase our discovery methods to bring in every possible asset into your system as a part of the discovery, and also be able to monitor your network continuously to pick such unauthorized assets accessing your IT network. That is the first point. And then the second point, after just building your asset inventory, rather than just mapping them to users, we need to take it to the next level, also have access to the privilege and entitlement logs associated with that asset, a software or a service monitor, wherein you continuously monitor the software that a particular asset is tracking, the services that particular asset is using, etc. And then being able to exercise endpoint control on that devices so that you can take action. Now, say, for example, you realize a particular device which is not of the latest patch version suddenly pops up into your environment, probably an old asset being switched on by an user, and your LAN recognizes it, and you discover it in your network. You should be able to quarantine this device out of your network to avoid any potential entry points, right? So enhancing your remote access capabilities to avoid any security pitfalls from any asset in your network. And one more key aspect as a part of IT asset management, monitoring the encryption status of each asset in your environment. Well, let me give an example, a very personal example. So here at ManageEngine, as a part of a travel request, say I request or is a travel request to travel to an event in London, the first part is me getting an approval from a manager, checking for my visa, booking my hotel rooms, flight tickets, etc. And as this workflow progresses, I would get an email from my IT team saying, "Hi Ashwin, we noticed that you have raised a travel request with the travel team for travel to London from X state to X state. And we verified the status of encryption. And we noticed that your laptop is not encrypted. Please report to your nearest pit stop and have your laptop encrypted immediately." So we've incorporated the encryption status as a part of our travel request workflow to ensure that any person who is on an official travel, probably carrying an office laptop or an office machine, has his laptop encrypted to avoid any issues later. Now, say, for example, the case that we saw, an engineer from the Paris Olympic losing his laptop. Ideally, if they have a proper encryption status and they have proper endpoint device control, they should be able to contain the data leak, right? So this way, a little bit of security awareness at each touch point on the IT asset management practice will help us increase the security level of our practices. So the fourth point, complement your ITAM practices with governance, risk, and compliance gaps. The next point is a CMDB. So here again, now say you have a static CMDB, which is built in this way. When an incident happens, if the CMDB is not properly updated, one could miss out on a critical a service or a database which was probably impacted, which could lead to a second event, right? That is what could happen. In this case, an incident happens, they use their CMDB for impact analysis, but the mail service is not mapped in the CMDB. So the mail service was not in the purview of the incident response and incident remediation. They fix the whole issue, assuming that everything is fine. But a week later, the mail service has the same incident again. So instead of having a limited discovery method for your CIs, manually mapping them and not having a dynamic CMDB, this is how your CMDB should look like, right? From patch compliance information to infrastructure event monitors, data monitors, access and privilege controls, and ADDM, all these information should converge onto your CMDB so that in terms of impact analysis and asset critical criticality score or security policy adherence, you have the right information. Now, if you look back, all the four use cases that we saw earlier could potentially have been avoided or handled better if they had this particular mode to populate their CMDB. So this is the final lesson. Keep your CMDB as a foundation of cybersecurity initiatives and ensure that your CMDB is properly populated with all the necessary information. So that is the fifth lesson. And the sixth lesson is much more relevant, is keeping up with expired certificates, right? So this is a use case where a company has 100,000 certificates and they end up having an availability incident because of an expired certificate. The sadder part, they don't even realize that the incident, the downtime is because of a certificate expiry. Now, something as simple as a certificate expiry could lead to, you know, critical services for your patients, for your healthcare professionals going down, right? And given the scale of certificates that any IT SM team or an IT team handles in the current day, this is much more relevant. Also, the period, the life cycle of a certificate has become shorter year on year or month on month, right? From 5 years to 2 years to 390 days to a point where some browsers might shorten this to 90 days also, which means that more security, more certificate expiries and a lot of manual work if you don't have it automated. So how should that be? Certificate lifecycle management should also be a part of your CMDB, where taking a particular resource or a particular service, you should know the certificates that are associated, the certificates that are approaching expiry. So even when an incident occurs, as a part of your incident diagnosis, you know that this is because of a certificate expiry. So you can immediately pinpoint on that and start fixing it. Or to even take a step back, become more proactive, you can trigger out certificate, a request for a certificate even before the certificate approaches expiry. Now, though this looks complicated, I'm sure there are a lot of simple tools which take care of the automated certificate lifecycle management. Now, the role of an ITSM manager or an IT service delivery head is to incorporate this automated certificate lifecycle management into your CMDB and incident management practices. So that is the sixth point, which is automate certificate lifecycle management end to end. And coming to the final point, which is securing assets on the go. This is very similar to the Paris bag theft that happened very recently. Say an employee travels on official purposes and unfortunately has their laptop stolen from a public place. So, like I said, without the asset being properly encrypted, without having proper endpoint control, this is a case for a potential data theft. So, an unsecured asset with sensitive data getting stolen, and there is a high risk of data being lost. So, as an ITSM professional, what can you do, right? First, you know, the first response would be that it is a duty of the particular employee to take care of his office laptop or office asset and ensure that it is not stolen or ensure its safety. But human nature, accidents happen, they could end up losing it. And the second response could be, why should it be and function of ITSM? It is the worry of a service security team. But ideally, this practice should be weaved into our IT asset management practices. Now, say, for example, the IT service management team or the IT asset management team could build a loanable asset inventory where instead of letting users travel with critical resources, you give them a loanable asset, which will just give them access to specific important services needed for their travel. So this is the first level of control that an IT asset management team could do. And the next part is a bit advanced. Establish geofencing rule. Now, this is basically stopping the user or stopping the machine from accessing certain services or performing certain functions based on their location, based on the network that they are connecting from, based on the public Wi-Fi that they are connecting from. So this way, one, you provide them a loanable asset which has very minimum permissions, very minimum access, or you set up geofencing tasks. So means that naturally or automatically you cut off access to very critical resources when this particular asset is being used at a location or at a network or at a Wi-Fi that it is not supposed to be. So by bringing in these aspects into the IT asset management practice, we can stop the potential access to critical data even on a lost device. Now add the function of endpoint control on the device. You could immediately trigger and remote wipe of data once the user reports that his data is lost to ensure that no data is accessed. So this way, you also bolster your IT asset management practices to safeguard your data from being stolen. So the seventh pillar is geofence any temporary asset or the assets that are going to be used outside your office network or office location. So summing up, these are the seven key aspects that you can start incorporating into your IT service management function. So by start, I don't mean necessarily shopping for all the plethora of tools and trying to tie them into your practices, but even as a thought process, extend our focus into these areas beyond the core ITSM practices that we mostly think upon. Patch compliance, privileged access management, zero trust principles, complementing ITAM practices, keeping your CMDB updated, certificate lifecycle management, and geofencing, to sum up all the points that I talked in the last 30 minutes. And like Mark said, we are a sponsor of this healthcare themed event. And to quickly show you a glimpse of all the various functions that I talked about and how they all tie into the Service Express application, which is the service management platform from ManageEngine, and how you can connect the various functionalities using other tools from ManageEngine to kind of achieve all that I talked about earlier. Now, that brings me to the end of my presentation. Thank you for taking the time to listen to me. And I hope this was an interesting presentation and you all have something to take back from this presentation. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity, Mark.
Thank you, Ashwin. Excellent. Some very good hints and tips in there, and a different perspective to round off the session today.